Do you have diabetes? Well, 6.5% of all diabetics will develop a foot ulcer at some point in their life. And guess what? 40% of the Western and now Eastern world is pre-diabetic. 10 to 15%, depending on the country, is true diabetics. This is crazy. So this is a video you definitely want to check out. We're going over the treatments, prevalence, epidemiology, and what you should be doing if you're a diabetic, and we're starting now. Diabetes is skyrocketing. In fact, even China is the number one country now with 40+% of people pre-diabetic. It's exploding everywhere in the world after the COVID lockdowns. We're all unfortunately getting fatter, less active, working from home. People are not moving for long periods of time. So this is something that we really have to stop. And as a result, something I work with all the time, diabetic foot problems, diabetic ulcers, we're seeing it go through the roof. Diabetic foot ulcers can happen in 6.5% of the population. The real cause of diabetic foot ulcers is that when you have diabetes and your blood sugar is uncontrolled, you develop something called neuropathy. So that means your muscles don't work well, your sensation doesn't work well, and you develop pressure spots like calluses. This leads to repetitive stress on the area of the foot. So your pressure areas combined with poor blood flow, this leads to a blister. So you can see underneath the big toe joint, there's a blister there. Then that blister ruptures. You don't feel any of this happening until it's too late, unfortunately. The most common types of foot ulcers are usually on the toes. So I see it underneath the big toe joint, the ball of the foot. But if you have a flat foot on the right hand side here, you can see it happens in the middle a decent amount of times. But the toes are probably the most common, especially the big toe or the fifth toe. Now there are stages and grades. There's about three or four different systems, but you could see grade one, it starts to develop. Grade two, it starts to get through the skin. Three, it gets bigger down to the muscle and the joint. Four, there's bone and joint. And five, that's when it's too late. Usually we have to unfortunately amputate the front of the foot. A diabetic foot ulcer first starts with diabetic peripheral neuropathy. It starts with numbness in the foot. So most people don't even know they have the early stages of diabetic foot ulcers. Basically what peripheral neuropathy is, means that the nerves in your fingers, in your toes are not working well. Now here's the trick. Peripheral neuropathy affects both hands and both feet equally. If one foot's worse than the other, one hamstring or one butt, it's probably not purely peripheral neuropathy. And where the trick is, peripheral neuropathy can be due to diabetes, to alcohol, to medications, to chemotherapy. There is 100+ different causes. The number one best thing you could do is get a doctor to properly diagnose it, find out exactly why you're getting it, and fix that cause. But number two, things like supplements, medications, lifestyle modifications, there's so many treatments out there. In fact, I have a book that I put a ton of time into. I go over this in detail. I review pretty much all the treatments, and we call it the Dr. 80-20 guide because I focus on the 20% most things that give you 80% plus results. That's really the key in this case, is you can get so bogged down by all these studies and treatments. You want to go for the most cost-effective treatments that actually get you results. You don't want to waste time with expensive surgical treatments as your first options or getting stuck in all these studies. We look at all the studies, we kind of rate them. We've made some guides because I see a ton of patients with these exact problems and they give me real-time feedback. If I'm giving them an expensive option, they're gonna come and try and fight me in the office. So I can't be doing that. I gotta get you guys practical solutions that are evidence-based and proven. And that's what we gotta do. That's how you take care of peripheral neuropathy, because there's so many great treatments, it's hard to make out which ones are the best option and which ones are a scam. Simple sugars, so high glycemic index foods, have been shown to damage peripheral nerves. The Journal of Diabetes Investigative Research found that low glycemic index foods definitely are correlated with better diabetic nerve function. Let's take a second to talk about the glycemic index. Basically, when you eat something, it measures how quickly your blood sugar spikes. Healthy foods don't spike your foods, unhealthy foods spike your foods. Fruit are a big misconception. Take a look at this food chart and pause it. This is extremely important. People treat fruit so unfairly. Look at how good it is on the glycemic index. Only really banana, which is overripened, or watermelon are sugary. The rest can be really good, but at the same time, don't eat like 50 fruit at the same time. More is not always better. And here's a good frame of reference to look at. As we move into the glycemic index, hummus, chickpeas, garlic, onion, green peppers, eggplants, mushrooms, lettuce, those are your best low sugar foods. But then you move into other fruits, even chocolate. So for your chocolate lovers, nuts, cashews, whole milk, not that bad. But then you move into more your coarse breads, your strawberries, your milk, natural yogurt, oatmeal, beans. Then 50 to 70 is where you move into more your breads, your sweeter fruit, your ice creams, your yogurts, your grapes. And then 70 to 100 is white bread, donuts, all the processed foods, corn flakes, French fries, potato type foods. Those are the ones to avoid. Check our links below for a more detailed list. And then blood flow is impaired, so arteriosclerosis develops. So not only are you more numb in the foot, but your healing ability decreases. If you're familiar with your A1C, studies show that for every time your A1C goes up by 1 point, your healing ability decreases by like 10 times. Not 10%, I'm talking like 1,000%. This is insane to me. This is something I take really seriously. And if you're in America, we provide home wound care services. In Michigan, you can come see me for your diabetes foot care. And I have a book, The 23 Simple Steps to Heal Your Diabetic Foot Ulcers. Check that out below. I put a ton of work into it. Diabetes is going through the roof. About 6.5% of all diabetics will develop a foot ulcer. That's a lot of people around the world, a lot of people watching these videos. And this is the number one cause of foot amputations. Unfortunately, I've had to amputate like 1,000+ big toes, little toes, and even feet or worse. People losing their legs below the knee. It's very common due to microvascular disease and wound infections. This is an emergency. When I see a wound, it's like a sprint. We gotta run as fast as we can to get this wound healed up. You can't take chances with these things. Out of that 6.5% of people who develop these ulcers, here's some horrifying statistics. If you have a diabetic foot ulcer, it's essentially worse for your 5-year mortality as all but 2 of your cancers. So only lung cancer and pancreatic cancer are more dangerous than a foot ulcer. This is horrifying to me. You have to take this seriously if you're developing scaliness or a wound or a problem. And very frequently, if there's diabetes, you have to look at the blood flow. If there's reduced blood flow, it's a combination of a diabetic ulcer and what's called an ischemic ulcer. The more blood flow you have, the better your diabetic ulcer will do. So the number one thing that you can do to improve your arteriosclerosis is seeing a doctor like me and vascular surgeons that we work with.
In the office, we could do some finger testing to make sure that the blood flow is adequate. If it's not adequate, then we would put cuffs around your ankles and do something called an ankle brachial index. So depending on set values and using an arterial Doppler, we could see how stiff and blocked the vessels are. So this is a great screening tool that every podiatrist should be able to help you out with. And this is what these waveforms look like on the Doppler. In that case, you can order SCT angiogram with 3D mapping of your blood vessels, so you could see the blockages, or at the same time, at this point, they could be at the vascular surgeon, essentially getting an angioplasty with runoff so they could diagnose it and treat it at the same time.
For a bypass procedure or an angioplasty. Angioplasty, that's essentially like a roto-rooter. Colleagues of mine called vascular surgeons make a small little poke in your thigh and or up in your body if it's other spots, but they go down with a wire. And on that tip of the wire is a balloon that expands and opens the artery. And then they can choose to place a stent. They use dye to see where it's narrowed, and then they balloon it open and then place a stent. The danger is you can't just balloon everything open because it could rip the artery and then you're bleeding. That's called a hemorrhage. So you don't want to do that. So what happens is the excellent vascular surgeons I work with, they essentially work their way down. I've gone to lots of surgeries with them, and they essentially expand that artery and place a stent if it's closing back down again. Now, this is a pretty quick in and out surgery. Generally, they do this in less than like 24, 48 hours and you're out of that hospital.
This is what a stent looks like. It's bendable, it's flexible. The technology is getting better every single day, but it does not last forever. Ideally, you want to get in as good a shape as possible, get your diabetes reversed, because sticking a foreign substance in your body will never work as well as just getting your body as healthy as possible. But if you have a problem, you got to do this quick.
If the vessel is completely blocked, and this happens where a full blockage develops, they actually have to cut that artery before and after and create a new vessel that goes around. That's called a bypass. That is a very serious and dangerous surgery, but has slightly better long-term outcomes. So frequently when I see people and they have purple toes or cold toes, I send them right away to one of my colleagues in vascular surgery, and they can do an angioplasty or a bypass, and blood flow within a week or two is going perfectly down to the toes. The person can use their feet, their hands again, extremely well. And you can do this in other parts of the body as well. So that's why we set up an organization that can come out to your house through most major areas in America. We can help with your wound grafting, offloading, protecting those feet. It's a huge dilemma. It's a huge problem that's exploding everywhere in the world. So you have to diagnose it properly and you have to treat it. Number one, what's an early stage diabetic foot ulcer? Diabetes is very high. First stage is having diabetes. You have to do everything you can to get better shape, improve your diet, increase your blood flow. I have videos on arterial sclerosis, diabetic diets, diabetic skin conditions, all of that below. Check those full guides. I've put a ton of time in these. I'm not asking you for any money. They're all free guides because I hate this disease and I want it to get better for the majority of people watching these videos. Early signs of a diabetic foot ulcer. If you have redness, swelling, warmth, if you feel with your hand and it feels warmer, or a callus or a corn, that's even considered an ulcer or a pre-ulcer. If left untreated, this can progress to a more severe stage where now red, meaty tissue is seen. This can lead to infections. Anytime you have a small cut or wound, bacteria can get in there, it can get infected, it can lead to a hospitalization. I remember one time I was looking at the hospital list and I had so many patients in the hospital. I think over 10% of patients were in that hospital with some type of foot problem or infection. That's a huge amount. So make sure to use a mirror, inspect the bottom of your feet. The first thing you gotta do is diabetic ulcer treatment. So I could go over prevention all day. In fact, I have a book about it. But good shoes, good diabetic insoles, good support, good socks, compression, get your blood flow tested, get your diabetes under control, get your heart under control, get some exercise, get some strength training. All this stuff makes a massive difference in preventing the progression and speeding up your healing. But when it comes to the specific ulcer, you need wound care. This is an emergency. Do not try this at home. Every insurance and healthcare around the world covers diabetic foot care because it is so important and it can lead to an amputation. So the first thing we do is clean up the wound. So in the office, we use alcohol, we'll clean it up, clean off any bacteria, any loose, dead, dry skin, clean off that callus. We'll put dressings on it. So we have a lot of advanced dressings. There's creams, there's ointments, there's padding, but the single biggest thing is you have to maintain moisture. If it's too wet, the skin edges can keep ripping. If it's too dry, it can get crusty, rip, and get damaged. You have to let that moisture leave, but you need some moisturizing lotion around it so it's not hard or too scaly. The next thing you want to do is offload. So number two, offload. You should have absolutely no pressure on that wound. The single biggest problem that I see with people is deformities. Tight knees, tight backs, tight hips. They lean all their body weight into their ball of their foot, their heel, into where that wound is. You have to treat this like an emergency. This is more dangerous than a broken ankle, but you'd wear a cast for a broken ankle. So the first thing I love to do is surgical shoe that gets pressure off if it's a toe. If it's somewhere on the heel, the bottom of the foot, ankle, a total contact cast with a dressing. We change that once or twice a week to keep pressure off that wound rapidly. For most people, that gets it healed up, especially if their diabetes and other health conditions are evaluated and controlled. And just to be clear, I mentioned this earlier, you have to get those health conditions under control. If your blood sugar is through the roof, you have zero chance of healing your wound. if your blood flow is blocked, you have 0% chance of healing your wound. Those things have to be addressed by your doctor as well. Again, we do that in clinic, and we even have people come out to the house to help with this. You have to make sure the infection is under control. If it's red hot, swollen, you need an antibiotic. You need that area flushed out, cleaned out. That's very important. Get that blood sugar under control and debridement. So surgery for a wound is kind of cleaning it up. That makes a big difference. Other things that can help are advanced therapies. So really popular now, and we do a lot of this, are growth factors and skin substitutes. It can be covered by insurance in the vast majority of the cases. So if you have a big wound, getting a skin graft on there, if it's slow to heal or not healing. So if you've had it for more than a month, a skin graft can help. A wound vacuum can help. So getting a wound vacuum on there can make a big difference. Getting pressure off that wound, very, very important. If that helped, check out that book, 23 Simple Steps to Heal Your Foot Wound. Get that checked out. We have home care services all throughout America. See if we cover your area. And if you're in Michigan, I would love to come see you. This is what we specialize in. Come check me out. Give me a thumbs up or tell me if I'm missing something. If you need some more advice or specific videos, I'd love to do that. Tell me down below.